listened to my secretary. She told me that it was a Halloween-themed Philly Tech Meetup and I should come in costume. Thanks for having me. It's great to come to events and see so many people here, and it's just sort of yet another sign of why I think Philadelphia tech scene is rising and growing. I thought I'd talk a little bit about sort of entrepreneurship overall and then talk about Philadelphia entrepreneurship. At a high level, having been in the tech industry now for over 20 years, I could say there's never been a better time to be an entrepreneur, especially in technology. The main reason why, and the main driver, is capital efficiency. The costs to get into the business have come down incredibly. When my co-founder Marvin Weinberg was here, we were co-founders of my first company in Phenotics back in 1991. And when we got started, it took us $5 million to get the first product shipped. We had to build a data center with a raised floor. We built a diesel generator out back, which would have come in handy the last few days. We bought expensive tandem hardware. Every single line of code we wrote ourselves. When we started Half.com 7 years later, it took us $2.5 million to get the first product shipped. We didn't have to build a data center. We could put our hardware in Exodus data centers. We didn't have to write every line of code. We could use some off-the-shelf packages. We didn't have to buy tandem hardware. We could buy Sun hardware. My third company that I was involved in founding was a company called Turntide, which we started in 2003. And that company got the first product shipped for $750,000. We didn't have to even build a data center. You could actually use the cloud now, finally. There were billions of lines of open source code. Offshoring had become much more efficient through tools and platforms. After I left Turntide, I'd been doing a bunch of angel investing, and one of my first angel investments was a company called Feedster. This was back in right around 2002, 2003, when blogs were just coming out, and search engines were only indexing the web once every 3 weeks, if you could remember back to that time. The concept of sort of the real-time web wasn't there, so Feedster was going to be this real-time search engine. They raised $1.5 million of angel money. I put some money in. And within a month of raising the money, they wrote checks out the door for $1 million because they had to buy hardware. They had to buy terabyte storage-attached networks and redundant RAID disk arrays. And, $1 million of their $1.5 million went out the door. If that company was starting up today, the founder, Scott Rafer, would take out his credit card and his first month's bill on Amazon Web Services would be under $300. And when you look at that and say, wow, less than a decade ago, it would have cost a startup $1 million. And today, they're charging it on their Visa card. Look at mobile. Even 7 years ago, if you wanted to build a mobile app, you were writing it in 14 different languages, and to get on the deck of one of these carriers, AT&T or Verizon, you were spending about 18 months negotiating a deal with the carrier individually. Distribution. When you were trying to get, when we built Half.com, we spent $6 million in customer acquisition in the first 6 months. We didn't have things like social. And now when you're looking at e-commerce companies, we're an investor in a company like Fab.com. More than half of their users come for free via social channels, via Twitter and Facebook. That's unbelievable. When you just look at the high level of an e-commerce company, when previously you might have spent $25 to acquire a customer that had a $35 customer lifetime value, the social channel makes that $12.50. It just changes the underlying economics. Mobile is now 30 to 40% of all e-commerce traffic. International is approaching 30% of e-commerce traffic. Just like those three changes alone fundamentally transform online businesses. So what you're seeing is the costs have come way down. In my own career, it's come down from $5 million to we see companies get off the ground now for $50,000. And it's just transformational because, you look at the dorm rooms of today's college campuses and there are hundreds and hundreds of iPhone-authorized developers. Any person could spend $99 and become an Apple developer and have the same exact opportunity as EA or Facebook or any of these large companies have to get on a platform. And that's transformational. And you know, that's regardless of geography. The second thing, though, is that there have been shifts that have sort of, I don't know if the world is flat, but I'll definitely say the country is. It used to be that technology was a business of sort of apprenticeship, and so much of the secrets of the business passed hands out on the West Coast. You know, when I was first getting started, there were magazines, just a few, like Upside and Red Herring, that talked about sort of the new deals and the new technologies, but that was it. And like, you just, you know, the way that you found out about things was just being at University Cafe on the West Coast out in Stanford, or talking to VCs. And VCs were often the gatekeepers to information. That's how you found out about things. When we started Infonautics, we made the rounds on Sand Hill Road, and we had multiple people that were interested, assuming we move our company out west, because geography and proximity played such an important role. Today, geography still matters, but the barriers, again, are way down. You see things like Hacker News, like AngelList, like TechCrunch, like Pando Daily, like TechMeme, that are democratizing information, that are sort of removing the barriers, the one-on-one conversations. And you know, we have companies, you could spend 3 days researching sort of growth hacking, virality, SEO, and learning these secrets that you used to have to learn through proximity. And that again is transforming the landscape, because no longer do you have to be in any specific ecosystem to build a company. And First Round is a national venture firm. We have offices in 3 states, in Philadelphia, San Francisco, and New York. And we fund companies nationally. And we're beginning to see more and more great companies all throughout the country. We've come to believe that great entrepreneurs can be born anywhere. Just like all great actors aren't born in Hollywood or Broadway, they move there for their ecosystem. All great entrepreneurs are not born in Silicon Valley. And you know, we've seen some great entrepreneurs all over the country. And increasingly, we've seen more great entrepreneurs in Philadelphia. I'm going to name 5 companies that got their start here in the last few years. AdMob started down on Penn's campus, sold to Google for $750 million. Invite Media got their start on Penn's campus, also sold to Google for $100 million. Milo got their start on Penn's campus, sold to eBay for $100 million. Warby Parker got their start on Penn's campus. They've just raised money, valuing themselves well over $100 million. Venmo got their start in Philadelphia. They were acquired for a little over $20 million. Those 5 companies have created over $1 billion worth of market value, and they were all started here in Philadelphia. Now, here comes the challenge, and here comes the rub. Every one of those 5 companies left Philadelphia to grow their business. That's $1 billion worth of value that left the region, from a tax perspective, but most importantly, from a knowledge perspective. What happens, you know, I'm a big believer in the Darwinian theory of startup ecosystems, that startup ecosystems aren't created by mandate, they can't be legislated into existence, task forces do not create a startup hub. Startup hubs are created by successful companies. Successful companies breed successful companies. It's not a coincidence that Yelp, Yammer, YouTube, and LinkedIn were all started by alumni of PayPal. And now you look and you're seeing the alumni of those companies, it's just like the forest. You know, the big tree drops the seeds, which then creates the next tree and creates the next tree. And it becomes very hard, though, to build this forest if all your seeds are picked up and brought to other cities. Philadelphia has incredible entrepreneurial talent. You know, I'm a big believer that our challenge isn't in attracting entrepreneurs to the city. Our challenge is in keeping entrepreneurs in the city. Because had those 5 companies stayed here, you would have hundreds of new angel investors. All those founding, look, Look what's happening with Facebook right now. It's the same thing we saw happen with Google. There are, you know, the Facebook IPO has created thousands of new angel investors. And we're seeing it already on a daily basis. It's created hundreds of new entrepreneurs. And it's created dozens of mentors and advisors from the founders of the prior companies. You know, and we see this in bits and pieces, right? There's a company in Philadelphia that we're an investor in, or the Philly region, called Monetate. They started, you know, the founder there, David Brusen, it's not a coincidence that he was the CTO and co-founder of Turntide, that third company I was talking about. He left Turntide, said, all right, I was CTO before, now I'm going to start my next company. He started off in our offices in Conshohocken, just himself. So guess what? Where'd he build his company? In Conshohocken. He now employs 150 people in Conshohocken and has 25 open job positions there. And that's because I think that there are three things that keep people in an area. The first is money. And I've said this a lot, and I think it's really important. If the money doesn't go to where the entrepreneurs are, the entrepreneurs will go to where the money is. Let me say it again. If money doesn't move to the entrepreneurs will move to the money. They're strapped. That's what they have to do. And that's one of the reasons why after, I'd say, 20 years of sitting on the sidelines, both literally and physically, sort of being out in Conshohocken, we chose to move our office to Philadelphia. That's where the entrepreneurs are. And I got tired of telling founders to get in a zip car and drive out 76 and come and visit me. And if you look at some of these great ecosystems that exist, look at California, Sand Hill Road. There are over 250 venture capital firms within a mile and a half of each other on one road. And they manage over $40 billion worth of capital. That's $40 billion for the sole purpose of funding companies. And it's right, Sand Hill Road is right across the street from Stanford University. Look at Harvard and MIT and the Square. The Boston-based VCs, they're all there. Yet in Philadelphia, our VCs are in Radnor. They're in Wayne. They're in Conshohocken, where I was. They're in Bala Cynwyd. They're not in the city. There are a few, you know, there's Genicast and Comcast, there's Mentor Tech. I'm not trying to say there aren't any. But it's incredible how through tax policy and other reasons, the city has really put itself and its entrepreneurs at a disadvantage. Now, there's just been some change, which is what allowed us to come, but that change also allows every other venture firm to come. And I believe that now is the time for venture firms to move to the city. Because if capital doesn't move to entrepreneurs will move to capital. And we've already seen, you know, $1 billion leave since 2007. And there are plenty more. You know, there are other companies that I didn't list because they haven't exited yet, but they started here. So the first thing you need is money in the region. You know, I think the Nutter administration recently announced Startup PHL, which is another attempt to try, and a great one. I think it's awesome what they're trying to do, which is to bring more startup capital to the region's entrepreneurs. Dream It does an incredible job. The incubator, you're seeing signs of progress, and I think that we're seeing more. I'm more hopeful than I ever have been about the signs that we're seeing, because a lot of it is grassroots. And that brings me to the second thing that's important, community. Years ago I was on the board of Innovation Philadelphia, which was a top-down mandated sort of Philadelphia will be an innovation hub type of group, and didn't see much traction there. But where I am seeing traction, it's from Philly Tech Meetup. It's from Philadelphia startup leaders. It's from the growth of all of the incubators that we're seeing here in the city. I mean, the co-working spaces, you know, it's phenomenal, because you're beginning to see this ecosystem emerge, not because it's legislated, but because it's sort of in the air. And it's why everyone is here tonight. And I think community is critical, and Philadelphia has a strong community. And I think that is a really strong reason for people to stay here. And the third reason is people and talent. I believe that in any region, what we've seen is that entrepreneurs can get a company up to the first 15 to 25 employees in any region. You know, we funded a company called Stumble Upon when they were in Calgary. And, you know, by the time they got to a certain traction point, they then said, I can't hit attract all the talent I want. We're going to move out west. We funded a company, ModCloth, in Pittsburgh. They got to about 50 employees in Pittsburgh, but then found that they couldn't get all the people they needed there, and they moved out west. We funded Backupify in Louisville. They moved to Boston. But, you know, what we find is that companies sort of hit this point where the first 20 employees they hire tend to be generalists. They're looking for the Swiss Army knife, right? They're looking for the person who one day could be the corkscrew, and the next day could be the scissors, and the third day could be the nail file. You know, like, that's what you need at a startup. But once you get to about 20 employees, we find that startups really begin looking for specialists. They want someone who's done this before. I need a growth hacker. I need someone that knows SEO. I need someone who, you know, I need a front-end developer who's done this specific thing. I need sales talent and management talent that have done that. And what we're finding is that's often part of the challenges, outside of, I'd say, the New York or San Francisco area. And, you know, that, what would create that? Well, if Warby Parker were here, those alumni really would create that. If Venmo had stayed here, that really would create that. So, you know, the only thing that creates that is success, because success breeds success. I look at the people I worked with in my earlier companies, in Infonautics, well, you know, the president of CD Now, you have, like, just other companies sort of emerged from that. At Half.com, my founding team have gone on to other entrepreneurial careers and created other companies. And I think that's what we need in Philadelphia. But the way to make that happen is to stop the flight of successful companies. You know, I'm excited about what we see, because we have something that a lot of other regions don't have, which is we have great companies getting started here, right? We have an advantage. We have an unbelievable university system that's just pulling people in from all over the country and all over the world. You know, we have great companies getting started here. We have the foundations of a really strong entrepreneurial community. And it's just that last piece. We're now seeing capital come to the city with not just us, but with Startup PHL. And I've already now been approached by two or three other venture firms sort of saying, how do we make the decision to move to the city? And I think we're beginning to see that happen. You know, and at the same time, we're also seeing that that to some degree, the boundaries of funding are coming down. It used to be when I got my first company, you know, VCs would only want to fund a company within a 30-minute drive of their office, because that's how they collected information. Well, I fund companies all over the country today, and I have access to their Google Analytics. I have access to their Salesforce pipelines. I have access to their QuickBooks. I have access to their RJ Metrics dashboards. We're connecting on Twitter, we're connecting on Skype. I have far more data today as an investor in a company 3,000 miles away than the CEO of that company had 10 or 15 years ago. And that's why we're seeing the beginnings of firms outside the region even fund companies here, right? I think it's great that Union Square Ventures in New York funded DuckDuckGo, and they're staying in Philadelphia. That's an awesome thing. So, you know, I guess to close, I think there is a lot going for Philadelphia. We have great entrepreneurs. We have a strong community. We have a lot of funding coming to the city, both moving to the city and willing to sort of fund over a geographic distance. And the final thing to tip, and I think we're seeing it, is you need to get those companies to stay in Philadelphia. And so if I was asked sort of what could the Philadelphia tech community do to help me, it would be, you know, A, don't move. And B, if you are moving, because, you know, if you're a company that is moving because you're experiencing traction and you feel like there's something the Philadelphia community is, you know, that the Philadelphia tech scene is not providing for you, give me a call. Let's talk about it. Let's try to figure out how or what Philadelphia could do to get you to stay here. I guess I'll stop and take questions now. Thank you. the question was, there's wealth here, but what can be done to educate angel investors to move fast and not give crappy terms?
Yeah.
Is that pretty much?
Yeah.
Okay. So,
you said much better than I did.
So, you know, part of the challenge is that a lot of the wealth in Philadelphia didn't come from tech startups. So that the people that have that wealth didn't create it the way that the Facebook folks did, or the LinkedIn folks did, or the Google folks did. The angels that here, for the most part, there are plenty of exceptions, but the vast majority didn't come up through this ecosystem. So they're learning. You know, I think there are programs that we're seeing that are actually, you know, getting some interesting traction. Open Angel Forum, for example, has gone on in Philadelphia. They funded 6 or 8 companies, and they've moved pretty quickly. You're seeing AngelList, which actually is now bringing angels, regardless of geography, into companies, and we've seen that move very quickly. You're also not just at the tipping point with crowdfunding. We funded a company called Funders Club, which does crowdfunding for companies to basically help them, you know, but instead of Kickstarter, where you're sort of helping to build a documentary or helping to get a cool widget, in this case, you're actually getting equity. You know, but accredited investors could invest as little as $1,000 in your company, which doesn't really happen in angel investing. And, you know, we've seen that the 6 companies that have gone on there in the last 6 weeks have raised $2.5 million cumulatively.
What's the name of that, sir?
Funders Club.
Funders Club.
But they're not the only one. You're going to see plenty more now that the crowdfunding bill has been passed. So what I also think is interesting is what Philadelphia angels haven't had before is competition. They haven't had other people that force them to move fast, or force them to sort of provide market prices. And I think what you're seeing now with tools like AngelList, or Gust is another one, or Funders Club, is you're seeing, again, the country definitely getting flatter, so that what you're introducing to an ecosystem is competition. You're introducing alternatives. Those alternatives might not be locally based, but we've seen plenty of our companies. Look, we're a seed investor in Uber.com. You know, the car service. They've grown exceptionally well. And, you know, alongside us were a bunch of AngelList investors that actually came in, that found the company and moved in through AngelList. And we're actually finding more and more, even in the seed rounds of companies that we're doing on the West Coast, that they're getting angels in that fashion, much more than sort of the angel groups or the meet and greets, you know, that sort of angel networking sessions there. So I think that if you're asking what can be done to sort of educate angels, it's to introduce competition, and it's to introduce them to sort of alternatives. And the best way that you can do that is through these national platforms. Yeah. So I mean, I've heard different things on this. Like Invite Media started here. Now they moved their office to New York, but they found that because they were tapped into the right vein pen, they actually kept their. They moved their business office to New York. They kept their engineering office here in Philadelphia, and grew their engineering team here because they had far less competition here for that talent than they would in New York. So I've actually seen it go up the other way as well, which is that if you're looking for entry level talent, just raw, you want like raw Ruby, you know, that type of talent, you can get that straight out of the Drexels and the Penns and the universities. And you know, so what they ended up doing is they found that internships were, you know, especially for people after their sophomore and junior year, not their senior year, but their sophomore and junior year, were enough that, you know, they offered a ton of them. Because what that did was it got people hooked in the, more than just sort of a job, into a culture, into a team, sort of sharing the mission, that when they, by the time they graduated, they were sort of sold on that company. So that's what we've seen some success in terms of keeping the tech talent here and having an advantage here over New York in terms of recruiting, because, you know, while there are great companies here, there are fewer of them, and your ability to actually tap into the tens of thousands of students that are in the region is a real advantage. You know, because look, we have 25 companies in New York City, and it's incredible what they go to try to recruit people, especially now that the banks, you know, For a few years, they had an advantage because the banks weren't really hiring. But now that the banks are really hiring tech, it's challenging. So when you look at, you know, from my perspective, when you look at the tax burden, you really sort of sit down and say, okay, there are three things. You have the wage tax. You have the revenue tax and the profit tax.
And the business privilege.
Yeah. For the most part, at least what I've seen in the companies I've invested in, the profit tax, you're not going to be profitable for the first 5 years of your company, 3 years. You know, if you're building a venture-backed company, if you're building a company, you typically choose growth over profits. So, you know, I look at the companies that we're funding, and, they're not optimizing for profitability, which is the biggest tax. That's the 6% burden. Doesn't impact you in those formative years. So what does impact you? The business privilege tax and the wage tax. Well, guess what? It's far more expensive in New York. In California, there's a 10% capital gains tax. You know, you're talking about, so at least what I've seen is that from a startup ecosystem perspective, when you compare it to alternatives, I'm not sure, I don't buy the argument that taxes, that you're seeing flight from taxes. Not one of those five companies that left Philadelphia, I believe, if you ask them, would list taxes as reason number one, two, or three why they left at their stages. So now, once you get, as you generate real success and as you're producing $5, $10, $20 million worth of profit, sure. But that's not the challenge that Philadelphia faces right now. I think the challenge that Philadelphia faces is, you know, at least from a tech scene, is keeping the seeds here. Don't let the seeds get scattered throughout the country. Keeping those, you know, before they sprout, just have them grow roots here. Have them sort of, you know, I wasn't from the Philadelphia region. But, you know, the day I graduated from Penn, we had 20 employees who were. And that's what kept me here. I was portable. I could have moved anywhere. But my employees were what kept me here. And I think that as you see companies that grow roots here, it might be their employees that keep them there. You know, and if at that point they choose to move across City Avenue to Bala Cynwyd versus the city, well, you know, then the administration needs to deal with that. But I don't, it's a lot harder for them to pick up when you have, you know, you're producing that type, you're that size and you're producing that amount of profits. It's a lot harder to move the whole company to New York or to San Francisco. Oh, I think crowdfunding could be pretty transformational. But not in the way that many people think. I don't think it's going to put VCs out of business. I actually think it's going to make VCs more successful. And the reason why is because what I believe you'll see is more crowdfunding for startup companies. More companies will be able to, you know, the goal of the first stage of a company for a founder is to do one of three things. A founder wants to validate, de-risk, or disprove a hypothesis. They want to validate their hypothesis, de-risk it, or disprove it. Hopefully not disprove it. But if they are going to, they'd rather do it as quickly and as cheaply as possible. If a company's going to fail, you'd much rather know that after 6 months and $100,000 than 6 years and $3 million, because, you know, your opportunity cost is just really is irreplaceable. And that's the goal of seed stage investing. It's validating, de-risking, and disproving. And what I believe you'll see, and that's the riskiest investment of them all. And what I think you're going to see is the crowdfunding platforms will make it easier for entrepreneurs to get the capital to validate, de-risk, or disprove. Successful companies will still need to scale. You're still going to need to hire. You're still going to need to invest, right? So, you know, Facebook's initial investment was $500,000. That validated, de-risked, and disproved. They then went on and raised over $1 billion before they went public. And so what I think you're going to see is sort of risk shifting so that the crowdfunding platforms are going to take on a lot of that early risk, and you're going to see the venture firms have the ability to sort of look at companies with traction post-traction, right? You know, right now, we fund PowerPoints. That's what we do. And, you know, entrepreneurs walk in and said, imagine if this existed. And we have to imagine if that existed. And, you know, there's nothing better, though, when you actually get an entrepreneur who says, this exists, and let me show you the data and why it's going up. And I think that crowdfunding could really change the conversation from the imagine conversation to the look at this conversation. I don't know, where am I on time? Over? Over.
Yeah, but it's up to you. So I think...
So I speak about Penn because I know that's where I know. That's the ecosystem I know. We're getting more connected into Drexel. You know, we just launched a new fund 3 weeks ago called the Dorm Room Fund. What we basically said is one of the real challenges dorm room entrepreneurs is getting that first check. That, you know, I know for myself that getting the first $100,000 in our company was a lot harder than getting the next million, which was even harder than getting, you know, and that was, you know, that was a lot harder than getting the next 10 million. So what the Dorm Room Fund is, we've set aside $500,000 that we will invest $25,000 a pop, so roughly 20 to 25 startups over the next 2 years, all founded by students. But here's the twist, we're not making the investment decision. Rather, we're just this week finalizing it. We are picking students to be on the investment committee. There are going to be 8 students that run this fund. Because look, Dell got started in their dorm room. Microsoft got started in a dorm room. Yahoo, Facebook, you know, these companies all got started in dorm rooms. And if founders are smart enough, if college students are smart enough to come up with these ideas, why aren't college students smart enough to identify these ideas? So our hypothesis is that no one knows the student marketplace better than students. They know who the hackers are and the hustlers are and who the posers are. And, you know, so what we're doing is we're actually going to be, it's an experiment, but we're going to be giving this $500,000 fund complete control to these 8 students who will fund about a company a month. We're starting initially with University City, but hopefully we'll expand out to the other universities in the region. You know, and I think you'll see 20 to 25 companies get funding through that over the next 2 years. You know, but I think universities, it's hard because from a university perspective, so I don't know the answer specifically as to what should be done to sort of connect Villanova startups, you know, but, you know, one answer would be to start reaching out to investors, hold demo days, hold meetings. You know, I don't know when the last time I've been to Villanova was. You know, I think I went there 7 years ago, I spoke. But I speak in plenty of classes at Temple and plenty of classes at Drexel and plenty of classes at Penn, but that's because I get the call. I think the biggest focus for me is on who has time. Who has the time to spend with you? You know, and it's pretty rare that you're going to have all three choices, right? You know, it's hard to find seed funding. It's hard to get an incubator. It's hard to get into an accelerator. You know, but for me, it's not about which accelerator gives you $10,000 versus $20,000 or the office space. It's about the time. And, you know, who provides the mentorship, the introductions, the connections that could give you that unfair advantage? You know, when I know for myself, you know, as a VC, the toughest part of making an investment decision isn't do I want to write the $500,000 check with that person. It's am I willing to spend the next 8 years working with that person, and am I willing to commit to that? And that's the hard decision, right? Because the relationship between sort of VC and company is a tight one. It's kind of, you know, it lasts. And you really have to sort of make sure you're willing to commit that time. I think mentors and advisors are wonderful. You know, and, you know, I've been fortunate to have many of them in my career. And, you know, I think that those are the people that, even if they're not through an accelerator, it's by going to events like this and meeting people who have been there and done that. It's by networking around and getting yourself out there. And the final thing, which is also fascinating, is that I don't think, you know, your, quote, networking has to only occur at physical events. It's amazing how many people I feel like I know who I've never met personally, you know, just because of social networks, because of, you know, things like Quora, people who are commenting on my blog who I get into a dialogue with. And then when they call me, after sort of having conversed online, of course I'm going to be willing to spend time with them because you've built that type of relationship. And you now, you know, venture capitalists and people in the industry are far more accessible than ever before because they have this online presence, this online identity that you could connect with. You know, you want to know what Fred Wilson's thinking at Union Square? You don't need to go meet with him. You just read his blog, you read his Twitter. You start communicating with him and following him that way. And there are dozens of other VCs who have that type of presence online. And not just VCs, but former entrepreneurs, you know, serial entrepreneurs, just people who are out there. And I think that, you know, in addition to the incubators and accelerators and funders, they really do provide really good, oftentimes some good experience and good perspectives as well. So,
yeah, so I'd like to give a round of applause to John. For those of you who don't know, Josh is also a prolific blogger. So check out his blog as well as if you're on Twitter, follow him.